Welcome. We'll start with plant kingdom. The first kingdom that we would be talking about is gymnosperms. Now, before we start with gymnosperms, let's have a kind of brief idea about the plant kingdom. Under the plant kingdom, we talk about the plants that make the seeds and they do not make the seed. The plants which make the seeds can be classified as gymnosperms or angiosperms. Gymnosperms are the plants which do not have flowers. However, angiosperms bear flowers. So, a good example of gymnosperm would be pinus. You have Christmas tree. Then you have flowers. Those which bear flowers, you have all the flowering plants like sunflower, tulip, rose. So, all those would fall under angiosperms. Now, coming on to the plants which do not make seeds, they can be classified in two ways. First is the plants which have well-defined roots, leaves and stems. So, all three of them are well-defined, but they do not make seeds and they are known as ferns. On the other hand, there are plants which do not have true stem, true roots and true leaves. If none of them is present, we call those as algae. If it has some roots or stems or leaves, we call them as mosses. So, those are the five major categories under which we talk about plant kingdom: algae, mosses, ferns, gymnosperms and angiosperms. Today, what we would start is with the plants that make seed but are non-flowering and which are known as gymnosperms. Again, an important concept before we start with. Throughout all our lectures, we would be using two major symbols. The first symbol that shows single hand shows the question that can be formed or is important for your multiple choice question. The other question which shows a double hand shows an assertion and a reason, and all those statements which are important for your assertion reason perspective would be looked after with this sign. So, throughout the lectures we would be understanding these terms and that would go on with all our further lectures as well. Now, as we said, we would start with the plants that make the seeds. Now, these plants are also known as spermatophyta or spermatophytes. Now, under this you have heterosporophyll, that's common, that means heterosporo, that means it can be either microsporangia or megasporangia. Microsporangia are the male gametes, megasporangia are the female gametes. Now, these are usually larger in size as compared to them which are smaller in size. A very important criteria for gymnosperm is there is no requirement for any external water source. Now, this was a predominant requirement for all the seedless vascular plants, and therefore these seedless vascular plants were classified as amphibians and were not considered true land plants, which is very, very important. So, they were not considered as true land plants. And these were considered as amphibian plants because for them water was essential. So, what happens is on a thin layer of water, the sperm which is motile floats and you have pollination or fertilization that occurs, and therefore there was requirement of external water source. However, this external water source is no more required for the seed bearing plants, which are the gymnosperms and the angiosperms. So, that's the first thing. Now, again under the sporophytes, as we said, you have microsporangia and megasporangia. Microsporangia are usually smaller in size and they are haploid. So, what happens is both of these are haploid, and when they fuse, it forms a diploid zygote. Now, under megasporangia, there are four haploids that are formed, of which three degenerate and one remains functional. And similarly, under microsporangia, you have one that remains functional, and finally you have a pollen tube that is formed, and through this pollen tube you have fertilization that occurs, and this process is known as siphonogamy. Now, if you look onto this diagram closely, you have a sporophyte. It would have the male cones and the female cones. Now, this is a classic example of a conifer. Under the gymnosperms, we classify species under four categories, one of which is coniferopeda, and that is the conifers, and here we are explaining that with the help of conifers. So, you have the male conifers, the male cones and the female cones. Now, to demonstrate this further, we have a male a female cone and a male cone. Now these male cones appear on the lower branches. However, female cones which are bigger in size appear on the top branches. Now what happens is they have wing seeds which they have the pollens which are moved either direct or by wind, which is anemophily. The method of the pollination is anemophily. Now we will talk more about the methods of pollination in a separate class. Now these pollens, when they come here, they fuse with the megasporangia that is present here, the ovules that are present here, and you have the seed formation that takes place. Now these seeds appear openly on the cones, as you can see here, and this is an example of a pine nut. Now this is a pine nut, and you have these pine nuts which are roasted. Now these roasted pine nuts are edible, which are also known as chilgoza and is one of the dry fruits. Now when you open this, you have the endosperm that is present, and this endosperm from this seed is the one which is considered as an edible form, and this has around 10 to 30% of protein in it. So again, to emphasize the same point, you have the male pollens that are the pollens that are released from the male cones and go on to the female female cone, and here you have the fertilization that occurs. Now what happens is this female cone classically releases resin, which is a kind of semi sticky material that is present. Now when pollination occurs by wind and this resin is exposed to air, it solidifies on the surface and you have the fertilization that takes place inside it, and therefore you have the process of fertilization, and finally you have seeds that could be seen, and you have seed dispersal that takes place. Now this maturity takes around 26 months for the coniferous. We are talking specifically about conifers in this example. We have all the four categories which we would discuss later. Now this maturity takes place around 26 months, and there is the fructification cycle that occurs in two phases. The first year, or in 2 years, the first year is the year of seed pollination and the second year is the year of dispersal. So you have a kind of 2 year fructification cycle that is seen, and finally you have the pollen tube that's formed, and this pollen tube, you have the pollen grains that go onto the ovule, and you have fertilization that takes place, and this fertilization finally leads to formation of seeds which are 2N or diploid. And these seeds, as we saw in the case of pine nut or chilgoza, is a diploid, and you have the endosperm which is edible, and that is one of the major importance of gymnosperm, which we would again discuss later in this class. Now as we said, you have the female organ which is megasporangia. It contains ovule, and this ovule has integument and nucleus, both of which are diploid and belong to the sporophytic generation. Now under this, if you go on to this diagram, you would see you have the megaspore, a spore wall, you have the pollen grain that enters into the egg cell, and finally a new embryo is formed. Now this new embryo that is formed is the future sporophyte, and this future sporophyte is 2N. So that is the new embryo that is formed. The outermost layer, which is the seed coat, is the parent sporophyte, and this is again 2N, and around that embryo and within that parent seed coat or the parent sporophyte, you have the gametophyte that is present, and this gametophyte is haploid. So that's very, very important. So embryo, which is diploid, is surrounded by a gametophyte which stores the food and is haploid, which is again surrounded by a seed coat which is the parent sporophyte and which is diploid, that is 2N. So that was one of the basic things that is being asked regularly. Now what are the major adaptations to land plants that could be seen in seed bearing plants? The first is there is no external supply. Now this is an important assertion reason question. We already discussed how, because in the seedless vascular plants you have external water that is required, since the sperms are motile and they tend to float on the water for the purpose of fertilization, but that is no more a requirement with gymnosperms and angiosperms. There is development of pollination system. In this case of gymnosperms, it's mainly by wind, therefore we call it as anemophily. The next is the transfer of megasporangium to ovule. Ovule has only one megaspore that is fully developed. So we said that there are four haploids that are formed, of which three generate and one remains functional. Then you have fertilization of the egg that occurs in the ovule. And finally, you have the embryo formation. This embryo or the ovule itself is transformed into the seed, which is finally dispersed. So that is the basic process that occurs. Now, what are the other adaptations for land plants? They must have extensive root system. They have, they should have a well-built vascular tissue system. So a good-built xylem phloem network. Then you have cambium, which is present for secondary growth, and a bark for protection. As we said, we would move on to gymnosperms now. That's our key concept today. Gymnosperms, the seeds are exposed. So as we said, you have the cone, and on the cone you have the seeds which lie exposed. So they are not a part of the fruit and they are lying exposed, and therefore they are naked on the megasporophyll and they are not folded within the pistils. That's the first and the important thing. Most of the gymnosperms are perennial and are woody in nature. The tallest is the Sequoia sempervirens and the smallest is the Zamia pygmia. Now these are sometimes the direct questions that are asked, so you have to memorize those. Again, there are two important things. So you have the pollen cones and the seed cones. Now these seed cones are the female cones and the pollen cones are the male cones. Pollination, as we said, could be either direct or by wind in the case of gymnosperms. Now under the male gametophyte, there are two gametes, of which one is functional. In the female gametophyte, there are four gametes, three of them degenerate and one remains functional. The seed is important because it contains endosperm. So as you can see, this is the endosperm of the chilgoza or the pine nut. Three important questions that are commonly asked as it is for the gymnosperms or under the classification of gymnosperms. The xylem has no vessels except in the netophytes. Some of the netophytes have the xylem. Then under phloem, they lie without the companion cells and the sieve tubes, and the sieve cells which are seen are not arranged end to end in rows. So they are not systematically arranged, we can say. So these are the three key characteristics of gymnosperm. Again, very important for your multiple choice questions. As we said, we would talk about the four different species and we would be discussing one examples from each species. So the first is Cycadopsida, that is the cycads, which are commonly seen and they are known as cycas plants. Then you have Gynkopsida. They are the maiden tree here or the Ginkgo biloba. Ginkgo biloba is the only living fossil or an important living fossil that we will talk about. Then you have Coniferospida. The common examples are the conifer trees, kind of pine, larch, fir, spurs. Then you have the Christmas tree. So all those are conifers. And Natospida, you have Natum, Ephreda and Welwitschia. Ephreda is important because from Ephreda you have a drug that is formed that is known as ephredine. And this ephredine is important for your respiratory diseases. So some, again, a very important kind of economical importance of gymnosperm lies with Ephreda, which is a Natospida, that's again very important. Now coming on to the first one, that is Cycopsida. The important example is cycads. We would be talking about this, the cycas. Cycas, first of all, is again a living fossil similar to Ginkgo biloba. So under the Gynkopsida, you have Ginkgo, that's again a living fossil. So first talk about cycas. So as you can see, this is a tree of cycas, commonly seen as an ornamental tree. Now why this has become an ornamental tree of recent? The major reason is because the agriculturalists are moving forward for removing the land under the cycas for more plantation crops and commercial crops. As a result, this is of ornamental use and is now being exploited or now being removed from the major stretches. The plant is dioecious. Dioecious is very, very important term that you would often on refer in biology. Dioecious means you have the male bearing plant and the female bearing plant on separately. So there are two separate plants, one which is male bearing and another which is female bearing, or one with microsporophyll and another with megasporophyll. Usually these are palm like trees with fern like foliage. Now foliage can be of two types in under cycas, that is petiolate and unipinnate. We would be talking about the foliages in detail when we will be discussing the classification and the structure of leaves. Coming on to the characteristics of cycas, they are predominantly xerophytes. They are formed in dry conditions, warm weather. Now they are used only for ornamental purposes, and the structure is a kind of columnar stem that could be seen with rhomboidal leaf base. So the leaf base is rhomboidal in shape and the stem is columnar. Again, if we talk about the leaf, you have the ridges that is seen, and on the ridges you have many leaflets that are seen, and under these leaflets are basically having strong, or I could say sticky margins with spiny margins more or less, and these margins can either be straight or ovulate. There are two types of leaves that are seen. The one are the upper leaves, which are the green ones, and then you have the lower leaves which are brownish, both of which have ramental hairs. That's again a very important MCQ question. Which kind of plants have ramental hairs? So the correct answer would be cycas. The next is the roots. Now coming on to the roots, there are two types of roots that could be seen for a cycas, the normal and the coralloid. Coralloid leaves, roots are important because they are irregular, they have negative geostrophic, they are branched like roots, and finally what is important is the coralloid do not have a root cap or a root hair. So some of the coralloid examples include good associations with blue-green algae from, for example, nostoc and enabena are some of the species which could be seen in good association with blue-green algae. Now coming on to the fertilization part of cycas, you have microsporophyll and megasporophyll. Among all the plant kingdoms, the sperms of cycas are largest, and again the egg and the ovules are also largest. Pollination occurs mainly by the wind, and before pollination, pollen develops into three cells, which is prothelial, generative and tube cell. Now this is again important. Sometimes there is a direct question, which of the following is the correct order, or the correct three kind of cells that are developed before pollination in cycas. So you have prothelial, generative and tube cells. Coming on to the microsporophyll, they are basically arranged in a boat shaped pattern in cycas plant. They have two sections, the flat fertile proximal region, which have the pollen sac in the sori region, and the distal bent sterile region, which is known as apophysis. The female cone is present in the brown megasporophyll, which appears as a rosette, and the ovules and the eggs are largest in the plant kingdom, as we said. Now coming on to the conifers, we already talked about conifers. Some of the major characteristics, first of all, they are found on either high latitudes or high altitudes. So latitudinally, if we go from 0 degree to north, they are found in the north temperate area predominantly, and by height they are found on the top of mountains and uplands. Some of the basic characteristics, the stem has a thick bark which basically has the purpose of storing the food. The shape is conical, so most of the snow that falls is washes away and there is no snow accumulation that could be seen. Needle shaped leaves are formed with thick cuticle and sunken stomata. The benefit of the needle shaped leaves are they have less transpiration because they have more of xerophytic conditions, less water availability. So they modify their leaves into needle shape. Again, in this region, in the northern temperate region, you have strong winds that blow. So to sustain those strong winds, you have needle shaped structures that are seen. Another important point for the conifers is the leaves of the conifers remain on the tree for 5 years, unlike the deciduous plants or other angiosperms. So they are also known as evergreen. They remain green for at least 5 years at a given slot. They are monoecious, that means both the male and the female are present on the same plant. As we said, males are smaller and present on the lower branches. Females are larger and present on the upper branches. Now, how does pollination occurs? You have pollen that goes through the wind, which is a kind of huge wind circulations or upper air circulations that could be seen. As a result, you have air currents that flow, and these air currents create a kind of yellow dust of pollens that could be seen, and this yellow pollens go and stick on to the resin of the female cone. So on the female cone you have the resin or the sticky liquid that is present on which the pollens stick, and when exposed to air they solidify. As a result you have the fertilization that takes place. Once the fertilization begins here you have the seed formation, and this seed is dispersed again by the wind, and if it reaches a good quality soil or an optimal soil you have a new gymnosperm that could be seen. Again, very important to note, if the mountain or the place is very steep or the slope is very high, what would happen? The soil would be constantly washing away. As a result there won't be a kind of fertile soil or mature soil, we should say, and as a result you would have, due to the lack of the mature soil on these regions which have very steep slopes, conifers are usually absent. They are not present in this region. So that's again very important. Leaves, we already talked about, are needle shaped, have thick cuticle, are leathery in nature, and the stomata type is very important, which is sunken stomata. We would be talking about more on the types of stomata in the separate class where we'll be discussing about the structure of leaf. Now, as we said, they mainly occur in not temperate areas. Only exception is Araucaria, and that is found in South America, New Zealand and East Australia, and it is the only conifer that could be seen in the plain areas or the mountain foothills. It's a very important exception and therefore is important for your multiple choice questions. Now, as we said, unlike angiosperms, you have gymnosperms which are evergreen. They can very well stay in xerophytic conditions because of the lack of availability of water throughout the year. Most of the time the water is frozen, and a very important characteristic is the enzymes of the conifers are important because they can remain functional even at minus 35 degrees Fahrenheit, where most of the other enzymes get inactivated. So it's again very important point that you must refer here. Now, talking about pinus, a good example is Christmas tree. So you have a stem with monopodial branching, that is long and rough. Then you have roots. Now the roots are very important under pinus. There are two types of roots. It's predominantly the tap root. These tap roots could be either normal or mycorrhizal. Normal are with root hair and root caps. Mycorrhizal are devoid of root hair and root caps. So that's one of the important things you must remember. Then we talked about the cones. So you have the male cone that is seen. So they are oblong, and under the male cone you would have microsporophyll that would be developed, and those are two oblong and parallel microsporangia that are developed, and they are present in the lower branches. As we said, pollens are spread by air currents and they form a yellow cloud, and finally meet or go on to the female cones where fertilization takes place. In the female cone itself there are two sections. The lower part is known as the bract and the upper part is ovuliferous. So on the ovuliferous part you would have two ovules with a basal region which is known as megasporophyll, and finally you have the wing seeds which are dispersed, and you have when a suitable soil is found you have the fertilization and a new plant that could be seen. And these seeds that we talked about, the pinnate seeds, are the roasted seeds which are finally coming up for human consumption. The next important classification is ginkgoales. Now under ginkgoales they are again the ginkgo biloba, that's again a living fossil. It was first found in the Triassic period. It goes up to a height of 30 meters. The leaves are in the shape of fan and they are bilobed. So these are the two important characteristics that are seen. Again, the venation is furcate venation. That's very, very important. Similar to the cycas that we have already studied, this is again dioecious. That means the male and the female plants exist separately. So, microsporangia and megasporangia occur on separate plants. These are unisexual since they appear on the separate plants. The inflorescence is like a catkin and they have deciduous leaves. Since they have deciduous leaves, that means they do not have evergreen leaves similar to coniferous trees. So, they have deciduous leaves that shed during particular feather or particular seasons. The endosperm that we already talked about, similar to the conifers, which, where the endosperm is edible, here again the endosperm is edible only if when it is roasted. Ovules, you have three layers of integument, microphyll and pollen chamber that is formed. Found and again an important question for your assertion reason, usually horticulturalists prefer the male plant instead of female plant for flowering or for horticulture purpose. The sole reason is the female plant has an unpleasant smell and therefore the most commonly used plants are the male plants here. Now, importance of gymnosperms we have already talked about. The first is the endosperm, which is the edible seed, is the part that is used for human consumption after being roasted. Then most of the conifers and gymnosperms have softwood. If we talk about the fuel industry, 3/4 of the fuel requirement comes from hardwood trees and 1/4 of it is fulfilled by softwood trees. Now from the softwood trees you have conifers, which is a good example, and only less of it is used for fuel industry. Most of it goes to paper and pulp industry. Then you have fiber board manufacturing, linoleum, the linoleum flooring that is commonly seen, and it requires sawdust. Then from these gymnosperms you have resin that comes out. Now this is a kind of semi-fluid that is secreted by special tubes that contains terpenes, resin acids and esters. It has the ability to retain water, it has antiseptic quality and is toxic to pesticides. Since it is toxic to pesticides, it prevents microbial growth. So any kind of microbial or insect manifestation on the gymnosperm is not seen because the resin is present, which is toxic to the pest. Again, an important question for your assertion reason. Now these assertion reason questions are commonly asked in AIIMS examination, so be very careful that you go through them very carefully. Resins are also used in pains, bronchitis and for expelling worms. Now resins can be commercially exploited into two ways. These are known as turpentine and rosin. Now there are different uses for the two. Turpentine is used as a solvent for paint, for wax and for polish. Rosin on the other hand is used to seal the joints. It's a kind of modification of resin, and as we said, resin is simply the sticky liquid that comes out from the pine tree, and because of which on exposure to air it solidifies. So this rosin, which is a commercially exploited form of resin, is used for waterproofing, sealing the joint since it's sticky and gets solidified later, and for preparing the writing boards. Again, ephedrine, which we talked about, is obtained from ephedra, is aims to cure various respiratory diseases and asthma. So we have a huge lot of question bank for NEET and AIIMS that is available at this link. So you can refer that. We'll be covering more lectures in biology, specifically class 11-12. Then we'll be covering the NCRTs, the biology section, the physics and the chemistry in the upcoming classes. So stay tuned. Keep subscribed with this channel. You would have many more updates that would be coming soon. Have a very good day ahead.